So I would like to welcome everyone, and first of all, I'd also like to thank Tamara and Susanna to organize this conference, and that we were invited by you. Thank you very much. And the other thing I would like to tell you that this is the first time when we wrote a text together with my colleague Zoltán Kékesi. So it's a kind of experiment how we can present this this talk together. So we will read the text, if you don't mind. I hope it won't be so disturbing. So although I studied art history, I'm more involved in the practice. I'm a curator at the Hungarian University of Fine Arts, where I organize exhibitions. For example, some years ago I organized Intolerance in Contemporary Art, where I invited Tamara Moises, that's how we met. And I also work with an artist group called Technika Schweiz, who will be introduced today. So that's my position, I would say, in this conference.
Thanks. I'm also very happy to be there. In the last few years, as a researcher, I wrote a book about Holocaust memory and contemporary art, and I wrote, among others, on the work of some artists from Israel, like Yerbat Tana and Eyal Sivan, who in their work reflect very critically to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and that's why now I get in contact with these topics through my research as an art historian.
Introducing two recent projects from the art scene in Hungary, our presentation addresses two key topics of the conference. First, the representation of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in Eastern and Central European art, and second, the relationship of art and activism in connection to the conflict. As a common point, both projects grew out of personal ties or backgrounds on the side of the artist. In her retrospective exhibition in 2006, Rosa Elhassan, a visual artist of Hungarian and Syrian origin, presented an installation with demonstration signs made by Thomas Sheik, a civil rights activist and an important figure of Israeli and Hungarian pacifist and vegetarian movements.
Talking about this installation 6 years after its realization in 2012, we cannot ignore the facts related to the recent political situation in Syria. In a time of new conflict, the artist's activity raises the question if a combination of artistic and activist engagement can formulate a mediator role to relieve political tensions.
Yathana, the collective man, made in 2010 a project by artist collective Technika Schweiz. Actually, this artist collective has two members, Gergely László and Péter Rákosi, they are both artists, but now they call themselves Technika Schweiz. And this project, Yathana, deals with the history of the Yathana kibbutz, founded by the Hungarian communist Zionists in 1950.
To demonstrate the unique features and similar methods of the two projects, we would focus on three important aspects. First, the specifics and significance of personal involvement in case of both artists. Second, the role of the archives compiled by the artists. Third, the different concepts of collectivity. And fourth, the reactivation of different concepts of collectivity in the present and different strategies of reenactment.
As a Hungarian Jew born in 1939 in Budapest, Thomas Sheik moved in the early 1950s to Israel and became later a lifelong opponent of Israeli militarism and anti-Palestinian politics. At the same time, due to the forming experience of living in a kibbutz, he became a pioneer of an egalitarian agricultural utopia. From the late 1990s until his sudden death in 2004, he was active in Hungary, where he met Rosa Elhassan in 2002.
Rosa Hermansen, born in Budapest in 1966, lived in her childhood in a socialist Hungary, in a monocultural society built on the repression of cultural identities and the prohibition of their representation in public life. The main effort of her artistic practice has been, from her early sculptural works in the 1990s to her performances and objects after 2001, to articulate heterogeneous identities like Syrian, Hungarian, woman, European, artist and mother, outside of the biased and normalizing discourse of Hungarian and or Western European societies. The experience of being an Arab woman after the 11th of September became a power force in her turn to a politically more explicit artistic practice, beginning with her series of performances, objects and drawings under the title R, Rosa, Thinking, Dreaming About Overpopulation.
In 2002, Thomas Schick had an exhibition showing his demonstration signs in one of the smallest and at the same time one of the most progressive non-profit galleries in Budapest. It's called Liget, this gallery. The show presented Thomas Schick as a social non-artist under the motto, it's not art, but an exhibition. Thanks to Thomas Schick's invitation, this small exhibition included a video documentation about Rosa Hermansen blood donating action.
This action was censored in the previous year by Ludwig Museum, a major exhibition place in Budapest, due to, I quote, the fear of the stir that might be caused by certain paranoid sectors of Hungarian politics. It asked that the action, through expressing sympathy for the Arab terrorists, might be labeled anti-Semitic.
The action made use of the widely reproduced media image of the Palestinian president Yasser Arafat donating blood in Gaza on the 12th of September 2001 to the victims of the attack in New York. By replacing the body of Yasser Arafat with her own, Hermansen pointed to the hidden relation of dominance inherent in the media action image. Thus, the exhibition in the Liget Gallery created a public situation in which the pro-Palestinian action became visible outside of the biased terrain of the Hungarian public sphere. Actually, this work by Rosa can be seen in this exhibition downstairs.
In 2006, Rosa Hermansen showed 100 demonstration signs by Thomas Schick in form of an installation in her retrospective exhibition in Kunsthalle in Budapest. One of the biggest and at that time one of the most progressive exhibition places in Hungary. It was not only an homage to a friend died 2 years earlier, in 2004, but at the same time, a reactivation of his politics and a restaging of demonstrations made in collaboration with him between 2002 and 2004.
During this later period, Thomas Schick and Rosa Hermansen composed together the Hungarian group of Gas Salon and organized public actions related, among others, to the war in Iraq and Afghanistan. These actions were held often ad hoc and oscillated therefore between a political demonstration and a performance made by two social non-artists. The installation consisted of objects preserved by Rosa Hermansen after the death of their maker. In this sense, the installation was based on the archive containing the material and political legacy of Thomas Schick. The objects were shown in the form of an installation which preserved them as a stage properties left on their place just after a performance had taken place, or on the contrary, as objects waiting for an act to be performed in the next moment. In this sense, the objects were shown in the state of an in-between, in a transition state after and before a political action.
Both temporal aspects of the installation achieve a reactivation of the objects placed from the storage room into the white cube of the Kunsthalle. The first aspect is a moment of mourning. Mourning, the second is a call to an action. The first reactivates the archive as a site of memory, the second as a source of activist energy.
This later aspect was implemented in a public action by Rosa Lavassan during the exhibition.
2 years after the previously mentioned exhibition in the Kunsthalle, a Hungarian artist group, Technika Schweiz, started a long-term research in Israel related to Yad Hanna. The outputs of the research were presented in Budapest in 2010, entitled Yad Hanna, the Collective Man. The project is personal in the sense that it tells the story from the beginning to the present day of the communist kibbutz named after Hanna Szenes, established in Israel in 1950 by Hungarian Jewish refugees, including the artist's relatives, András Richter and his wife, two Holocaust survivors.
The exhibition at the Ernst Museum was a kind of summary not only of the research, but also of the story of the community so far. Once the common property of the community, the land was privatized and plotted, and people were almost totally isolated from one another. Besides the descendants of the original settlers, today the Yad Hanna is inhabited by migrants from different parts of the world. European, attracted by the communal utopia, guest laborers from Thailand, and refugees from Darfur. The first stage of the research was archiving. Using photos left by the founders of the kibbutz and documents of people who live there today, Gergely László archived more than 1,200 photos, indexing them and creating a searchable database. Actually, this is not the real database because he worked through the computer, so all the images is categorized in his computer. This is just an image how he started the archive, actually. The archive concentrates on such community matters as farming, agriculture, buildings, and celebrations.
But the artist did not present it as a researcher full of archival documents to tell the story of Yad Hanna. There were two other outcomes of the fieldwork.
The first was more than 50 hours of interviews. The edited films related to different protagonists of the life story of the kibbutz, original settlers, homecoming young people, immigrants, were also shown in the museum. The third stage became a theater play where friends and acquaintances are the amateur actors who reenact the episodes of the narrative of Yad Hanna to the audience. This play was based on both the archival materials and the interviews made by the artist, who himself sees the story of the kibbutz as a historical stage that sums up dramatically numerous chapters of the history of Europe, Israel, and Hungary.
Like the material legacy of Thomas Schick, the archive built by Gergely László preserves a segment of both Israeli, Hungarian, and European history. Although Yad Hanna is not centered around the individual life story of András Richter, both installations by Rosa Lavassan and Gergely László were related to the utopian life projects of an Eastern European Hungarian Jew after the Holocaust. Although differently, both of these life projects were deeply committed to the idea of a peaceful coexistence of Arabs and Israelis.
But the interview with Moshe Greenberg shows the current state of this period, of this project, after the fall of the kibbutz, the decay of its original politics, and especially after the Second Intifada in its ambivalence. Moshe Greenberg is employed as a keeper of the wastewater reserve, which collects the wastewater of the neighboring Arab city, Tulkarem. The reserve was built in 1979, and originally it grew out of an exceptional agreement between the Jewish and the Palestinian communities. As an amateur nature photographer, he took thousands of images picturing the lake and its animal life. At the beginning of the interview, he speaks of the beauty of the lake, the Arab city, and the sunshine, reflecting on the facade of its houses. Later, he recalls nostalgically the times as people from kibbutz used to visit the city and drop by for a coffee.
Only after being faced with the question whether he was surprised as the wall was built, he begins to take the presence of the wall into consideration. He tells that he agreed with the building of the wall, and the interview ends with some sentences emphasizing again the beauty of the lake. But as this interview tells us about the politics of an aesthetic perception and of a nostalgic feeling, do they transcend antagonistic relations, or do they simply help to cover and thereby maintain them?
By presenting the video and a series of photographs taken by Moshe Gimbel side by side, the installation points to this tension inside the notion of aesthetics. Although the visual style of the exhibition was far from rigorous anti-aesthetics, the amateur-like stage design and performance can be regarded as an answer to this tension.
One group of the photo archive consists of images documenting the Purim place from the 1950s to the 1990s, from the early years of the kibbutz to the dissolution of the community. Purim spiels played in a non-religious manner were an important part of the community life in the kibbutz and, at the same time, a public performance used to reflect, often ironically, on the political situations both inside and outside of the kibbutz.
For the Yotvana project, this collection of images was taken as a point of departure. At the center of the exhibition, the stage with costumes, props, and stage set was displayed, manufactured after the theatrical imaginary preserved in the photos. In the course of the exhibition, this stage became the site of a play written by Gary Laszlo on the basis of interviews made with older and newer members of Yotvana. If not only record a community event that is no longer part of the everyday life of Yotvana, but it's also transformed the archive itself into a theater in which the works displayed in the exhibition enrich the stage prop inventory of the Gesamtkunstwerk.
Along with the appropriation of the secularized charm of the Purim spiel, modalities of self-irony and humor were brought into play too. Regardless of the meaning in the context of their original use in the kibbutz, in case of their reenactment, they created an ironic distance to the history of the kibbutz and its communist utopia. The exhibition documented the end of a history of a utopian project which cannot be evoked without a portion of irony. But irony doesn't exclude empathy and engagement.
The audience saw an amateur theater group playing self-ironically the history of a group of amateur utopians and history makers. And, as you all know, amateur comes from love. This suggests that it's a love for collaboration and collective creativity that formed the idea of communism can be learned, reactivated, and transmitted in the present.
The first sign of the decay of the utopian collectivity in Yatvana was the disappearance of Purim spiels, previously one of the most important events in the life of the kibbutz. The final part of the play is a collective act where the only remained objectified symbol of collectivity, the collective house, the yellow house itself, was taken to pieces by members of the community.
The video showing the borough as it falls into pieces and burns down is the final episode not only of the exhibition, but the life of kibbutz as well. The last remained piece of collectivity is abolished. The project is related to the original meaning of the word kibbutz, interpreted by Technical Schweiz in the terms group and to collect, are revived in the form of a collective play, where memories are collected and interpreted in the collective work process of community. Although it can take place under various levels and in various forms, it's a vital interest of all of us to keep this practice alive.
Collaboration constituted a central component of the project. It became the form of the work, and it was, apart from personal affinities and historical ties, the main aspect that attracted the artists. The archive of Yad Hana meant for them not only a photographic memory of the kibbutz, but at the same time a source of inspiration for a collaboration-based artistic activity.
The history of the kibbutz served as an archive impulse in the sense of an art historian or foster. Archive art is as much pre-production as its post-production, concerned less with absolute origins than with obscure traces. These artists are often drawn to unfulfilled beginnings of incomplete projects in art and in history alike that might offer points of departure to the game.
Although the kibbutz as an ideal form of living together reached its end, Yad Hana as an art project using, playing, elaborating the forms, functions, failures and success of collectivity could transform its utopian energy into further collective art initiatives in the framework of art institutions and the exhibition place.
On the other hand, Thomas Schick's demonstration slogans made a tour outside of the Kunsthalle. At the same time, his legacy has become part of Rosa's way of thinking and artistic strategy. His motifs and slogans survived and were reactivated through her drawings and aquarelles as well. Already a year after the exhibition in Liget Gallery, Rosa began a series of drawings reflecting on the demonstration signs of Thomas Schick.